Do you want to be an avid angler? Do you want to hook that big one like the pros? If your performance looks like this, we'll show you how to look like this in no time. We'll show you the correct equipment to buy, what bait to prepare, and the correct techniques to follow to make a weekend hobby into a decent sport for the whole family to enjoy. Become a part of the biggest sport family in South Africa. In the first episode of the series called The Art of Fishing, we'll be visiting the beautiful Limpopo province in South Africa, where we'll show you how to catch bass the correct way. For this, we have asked Bassmaster Alan Kenny to show us the ropes on the Zanine Dam. So, grab your tackle and let's go!
I come with a bit of experience. I've been around for the last 25 years. I've got my provincial colours and my divisional colours, and this is what I love to do. This is what I've enjoyed doing since 6 years of age. So this is what I'm going to do to you today. I'm going to show you the basic introduction on how to fish ponds and how to fish lakes from a boat and from the side. The best way to start from pond fishing is with a spinning rod and reel, which I have here in front of you. It's easy to control, easy to cast, and if you keep your line tight, you're not going to get any overwinds. Second option would be to use a bait caster. This is for the more experienced person, but the technology at the moment is coming on so well that it's actually quite easy for everybody to use, and highly recommend it. To have a good quality line is essential in good quality fishing. You can go cheap and really struggle, or you can get good quality line. The three different types of line which is used predominantly in bass fishing. One is a standard mono, which is I use big game, which I find is very good for me. It's a nice floating line. Then you have your fluorocarbon. The fluorocarbon is essentially good, and there's some very good quality makes out there. This is currently what I'm using at the moment. And it sinks, and it's much heavier, it's much easier to detect the bites. And if you really want to go big and wild, you go into the braids. The braid is a fantastic line. Again, very many qualities, types you can get out there. But this braid is fantastic for me, and it works for me well. Pond fishing at the moment is the easiest way of catching fish from the side, and the most comfortable way of doing it is with plastics. I'm going to show you how to rig a basic Mojo rig. You're taking your line, putting a sinker down. This is a straight sinker that we use. It's to get the weeds, it's easy to come through the weeds in it, and you can use different weights depending on how windy it is. You can use the big ones for heavy wind and the light ones for no wind. Bring this thing down to a determined size, and then this is a fantastic tool. It's called a bobber stopper. This is a bobber stopper where you put the fishing line through the line, the hook through the line, pull it up, and you now have a plastic bobber on your line. This is not going to affect the line, it doesn't damage the line, and it's perfect because it holds the sinker in place when you want to go fishing. At the end, you put your hook. Your hook must be determined on the size of the lure that you're using. Don't use a big lure like this and expect to put a small little hook on like this. This size hook is perfect for the basic baby fluke or your senkos that you're using at the moment. I'm just going to tie this with a polymer knot to show you how to work that. Double the line up, putting it through the hook, the eye. What I like to do here is do a granny knot, standard granny knot, which comes to that, and then you pull your hook through the loop. Pull it up slightly, take your short end, pull it up, tighten it. You have now got a double loop through the eye, and it's a very small hook indeed, which is fantastic for rigging your plastics. Then all you have to do is trim off your short piece, and that will last for most fishing excursions you can do. Whether you're bream fishing, carp fishing, bass fishing, that is the knot that I would use. Okay, as I said to you, you then pull your rubber bokki further down. Your rubber worm is on the end. That is how you would rig a basic Mojo rig to go fishing from the side in the weeds, trees, bushes, to use on a boat or ponds, but highly, very, very effective for pond fishing. Then to rig your rubber worm, you take your standard fluke, again, put it through the nose, come round. It's always important to make sure that whatever plastic you're going to be using, it becomes straight at the end of the hook. So you must always make sure that it's straight, push it right through the plastic worm, and then you skin hook it by pushing the hook into the rubber worm. That's called skin hooking. You can pull that through most conditions, most reeds, trees. It won't get caught up, but if fish eats it, you'll go right through it.
Another very good technique when you're fishing from ponds, if you want a weightless presentation, you're just going to be using the weight of the hook on its own with no sinkers whatsoever. So let's put the sinkers away. What we're going to do is just retie this hook like I showed you just now, doubling up the line, putting it through the eye, basic granny knot, like that, coming through the loop, putting it down, grabbing the shorter end to pull it tight, cutting the end off, which gives you hook on your own. This is all you need for most fishing conditions, whether in the boats or from the ponds, but highly maneuverable for outside fishing. Putting a fluke on again, let's put a senko on this time. Putting a straight hook on, a straight senko on again, very important to make sure that the rubber worm always remains straight. There are so many different combinations of plastics you can use. And there again, it is pretty straight. Get your hook right through and then skin hook it by putting the plastic back into the hook like that. It makes it 100% weedless and it's straight. That you can throw anyway. We're using it weightless like that is a fantastic way of catching fish. Another phenomenal technique to use on pond fishing is to use surface lures early in the morning when you've got an overcast day or that's nice and cloudy. This is a fantastic lure to use for pond fishing and also on boat fishing, but ideally if you can get into the sides with this, it's a fantastic lure. It goes on the top, it spins as it goes around, phenomenal tiny torpedo. Then you have the pawpaw. The pawpaw is a fantastic lure because it stands like this in the water with these chicken feathers at the back here. This makes it an enticing lure for bass to eat when they have this early morning bite. As the sun progresses and it gets up in the morning, from about 8 o'clock to 10 o'clock, the little stick bait, which works just underwater. This is a phenomenal lure to use. You can use it early in the morning as well, but at the moment it's ideal when the fish are just under the water, under the surface. Again, the feather tail makes it quite enticing for fish, and this thing you can use by jerking it back and forth and letting it sit and then jerking it, carry on, and jerking it and bring it back to the side. When the fish aren't biting this because they've gone a bit deeper, it's now time to go up to the next level. This is a lure that goes down to maybe 3 to 4 feet, not that deep, but it is also fantastic for pond fishing because you're not going to get stuck in all the trees. It's an ideal lure, and because of the square bill, it's very hard to get stuck in trees. As you're going along, if you don't have trees and weeds to worry about in the dams, you can go to a lure with a slightly bigger lip. The lip means it'll go deeper in the water, and I've just caught this other lure here quickly. It'll go slightly deeper. This will go maybe to about 6 to 8 feet of water, depending on the size line you're using. And fantastic when it's a very bright day and the fish are going deeper. If you're fishing next to a dam wall and you don't have any structure, then you can even go up to the Bill Normans, the big DD22s. These are fantastic lures to go down to because these can go down to about 12 to 14 foot. Again, this is to get those fish that are down deep. Okay, the one rig that I wanted to explain as well is the Texas rig. This rig is fantastic to be used when you're fishing structure that you need to get into it, in the middle of a bush, in the middle of a brush pile, or even fishing the weeds. Again, use your same bobber stopper that you can get at most bass shops at the moment, pushing the rubber stopper onto the line first, putting it onto the line first, then afterwards you follow up with your sinker. I use the tungsten sinkers, and then a little glass bead behind that. Okay, when that rig is on like that, you're then tying on your standard hook. I'll use the polymer knot again to show you how to do it again. Doubling up your line, coming through the eye, doing your granny knot, coming through the loop. Cutting your tag on and off. Don't use your teeth, you just damage your teeth. This is now the perfect Texas rig where the bobber stopper can be put anywhere you want here, and this will keep the sinker in place when you're going over trees and limbs, and at the same time it allows the sinker to bang on the glass bead making a rattle, and that's what ideal for Texas rigging. You can use it with the glass bead or out. I like to use the glass bead when I'm using it. And then This technique, you can use a multitude of rubber worms. Any creature bait will do, which I like to throw here. Just rig this one quickly. Again, as I said, make sure the rubber worm is always straight. It's essential that you keep the rubber worm as straight as you can when you're throwing it. That is now the rubber worm rigged with the sinker on it. That's how we throw it in the trees, in the brush piles, in the weeds. Yeah, these are G-Lumas rods, which actually indicates to you on the side of the rod what technique this rod is used for. It's an easy way for learners to get into the right rods that you'll be using. This is a Texas rig rod, which I've rigged a Texas rig on. Easy for me to get organized. The next rod I like to use is this jigging rod, which again has got the picture on to show you, and that's the jig that I throw here quite often on Zanine Dam and other dams locally. It's a fantastic combination, strong and what you need. Another very popular rod is the standard Senko rod. This rod you can use 5-inch, 6-inch, 7-inch, or even the 4-inch Senkos, or you can use basic flukes, entirely up to you. But this is a fantastic weightless rod to use. It's got the right bends, the right strength, the right everything to pull any fish that, from wherever it's get caught. Topwater lures, again, phenomenal. G-Lumas have come out with a phenomenal combination. This is a stunning rod. You can also get them in different lengths, but this one suits me for my type of fishing. You could get the shorter one or the longer one, but this is for ideal for me for my topwater baits that I'm using, and I'm having a lot of success on it. Another old favorite that I've had this rod for about 4 years now is the G-Lumas spinnerbait rod. It works for me. Other guys don't like it, but it works for me. It does everything I asked it to do and more. As mentioned before, this is a fantastic lure to use in the shallows, in a pond, or even from a boat fishing. A jerkbait reel and rod combination is a phenomenal combination together. It works well for me. Again, you don't have to use this high quality stuff, but there are many rods and reels that come out telling you what lures to use with what type of rods. This is the standard spinning rod that we use. This is for drop shotting. Again, it works for me beautifully. It's ideal for the combinations you use, but if you want to use it just for standard weightless fishing or light crankbaiting, you're also welcome to. What I've tried to do here is get the basics of bass fishing to show you guys what is needed for pond fishing and for basic dam fishing. Tomorrow we'll go on the dam and I'll show you a bit more techniques to use, but we've shown you what lines to use, the rod combinations you can use, and the few rigs that you can rig, the Mojo rig, the Texas rig, and the weightless rigs. Showing you a few combinations of crankbaits and surface lures. This is basically all you need to start bass fishing. You don't need tons of tackle, but it is nice to have a combination. See you tomorrow on the water.
There are different types of bass you can catch in South Africa. Smallmouth bass, largemouth bass, and of course the standard black bass and the Florida bass. There are other species in Natal, but they are very hard to catch. Smallmouth bass can be caught in the local dams, but they must be in the higher country, such as Ebenezer Dam, where the water is much colder. However, 90% of the dams in South Africa have the standard black bass and the Florida bass, and it's a stunning fish to catch because it's a predator and a bully and will attack the bait you put next to it. That makes it so much fun to catch as a sport fish for most of the anglers out there. Yet, Lady Luck is not smiling down on Adam as yet.
We started this morning with the surface lure, the pop-up. We got about 6 fish, most of them small, and not a very aggressive bite. So now what I'm going to do is go back along the same bank, and I'm using a stick bait to get down a little bit deeper. Let's see if those fish are a little bit deeper, and we can see if we can catch them now.
Okay, what I've got at the moment is a smaller stick bait that I used this morning. The fish, there are many millions of little guys in the back, so I'm going to go to a smaller one to try and match the hatch to see if I can catch a bass with this little lure. I'm up in the waterfall at the moment at Zanine. I'm sure there's a fish at the back here. We've come up to the river here to try and work out how to catch these bass. We started again with the pop-off, the surface lure. Because it's overcast, it's nice dark conditions, fishing should be relatively easy. But again, as I thought, the bass were very aggressive, they didn't touch it. We went down to the stick bait. The reason why I went to the stick bait is because in the backs of the shallows behind us, you'll see that there are a lot of pied kingfishers there, a lot of activity with the bass, and again, we couldn't get them to bite. So what I've got a feeling at the moment is there's something wrong with the pressure. Maybe the bass have gone into deeper water. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to go and fish areas with this Mojo
rig with the fluke at the back, trying to get down deeper, maybe 10 to 20 foot, and work out where these bass are. They're not up in the shallows at the moment. We've been at this for an hour and a half. Still lots of time to work out where the bass are, and this is what I'm going to do now, work with plastics deeper and slower. Okay, what I'm going to be doing now at the moment, I've got a new fluke on, I've just caught a bass. I'm going to put some orange dye, yellow dye, chartreuse dye on the back tail to see what it makes a difference.
It's got a smell.
Very strong smell and a very strong dye. So if you get it on your clothes, you're in trouble. If you get it onto the boat, or the carpet of the boat, you're also in trouble. That's now made that nice, beautiful chartreuse tail. I've just had a bass eat my little fluky with my chartreuse tail, and he messed up my fluke. So I'm gonna go and catch him again with putting more chartreuse tail on him again. Just get the back tail. It smells wonderful. See you in a few minutes with a bass. All right, what we've done is we moved to another spot at the moment, the back of a bay, Bamboo Bay, we call it in Zanine. And what I'm going to do, you'll see, notice that the sun has come out. So it's got very quiet, the sun is out. So I'm going to be throwing these plastics, the flukes, under a Mojo rig. And when I get to the back of the bushes, I'll be throwing this Texas rig, which is allowing me to, with this creature bait, to get to the back of the actual structure without getting tangled up. It's the plastic is rigged into the plastic here, and the Texas rig will keep it nice and deep. It'll make, go right down in between the stuff, and we'll see if we can catch a fish there. Okay, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to show you how to throw this Texas rig into the back of the reeds. I'll show you how to get close by, and that's why this rig is so important. Okay, I've come up into a river now at the moment, and what I'm going to try and do is work in the back of this river. There's a little dam wall that's underwater here, but I'm going to try and fish it down in about 15 foot of water, still using the same Mojo rig that we started off with. And even I've got five. That's number five. We've got our five, quarter to 12. Not too bad, but we now need to catch bigger fish. I caught my fifth fish on a smaller stick bait. I'm now going to upgrade because I've got five fish. In any bass tournament you're fishing, you've got to get five and you need to get bigger fish now. So I'm going to put the smaller one away, put the bigger one on, and hopefully catch a slightly bigger bass.
Thank you.
We won't use it.
No, we won't.
We're at the situation at the moment, we've got our five fish, they're small. We caught them up in the shallows, up on the back of the rivers. So I reckon at the moment to find some bigger, better fish, we're going to have to go into the deeper water. So I've got a slightly small tungsten weight on a fluke to use it as a Texas rig. Because there's a bit of a wind, I just want to get it down. Otherwise I'd go weightless, but I need to go down to about 15 or 20 foot. So this is ideally, I think, what we need at the moment.
Okay, as mentioned, we had to go down to deeper water to catch the fish. This is a slightly bigger one than we're catching at the moment, so I'm a lot more happier. So I'm going to spend a bit of time now in the deeper trees, in about 20 to 15 foot of water, to see if I can catch any more like this. And then we can cull out the small ones that we've caught this morning, which makes a better bag for a competition. That's what we're looking for, those type of fish, not the babies we were catching just now. These are the fish we're trying to catch, not the babies we're catching this morning. So a few more of these, I'll be a bit happier.
Now, big mouth, huh?
Large mouth. Right, the bigger fish again than what I started with this morning. 9.
Yeah, okay.
We've come into the middle of the dam. You can see the brush and the brush piles here on the 3D. That's a 3D, that's a normal standard 2D. You can see the fish hanging off this water in about 20 to 25 foot of water. So that's why we've come out here, to see if we can catch some fish in the deeper water on the brush piles. Okay, back to basics. This morning we started off, a lot of cloud cover, a lot of overcast, good conditions to start the surface there. We started with the pop off. We got quite a few fish, but very small. We got one keeper, which wasn't very good. So what we did is, as we went on in the day, we upgraded to the stick bait. We got the odd bigger fish, but again, still small fish up in the shadows. We then went down to the plastics, and we used the standard Mojo rig with the fluke, and we got one or two more fish on the Mojo rig with the fluke. Up the river, we went a bit deeper again, and we used a slightly deeper crankbait, which I've lost. Which is over here now. Slightly deeper crankbait, goes down about 5 to 6 feet, and we got one keeper on this one. Then we decided to come out the river. Coming out the river, we went back into the deeper trees to go and find bigger fish. We found one fish on a Texas fluke in about 18 to 15 foot of water, which is quite good. And it gave us a pattern to go to. We must go to cleaner water, deeper water, and to see what we could do. We carried on there, we didn't catch another fish. But we went to a point that had a nice deep bank on it. It was 20 foot close by to it with a lot of brush piles. We went with a stick bait, and we very quickly, on the same stick bait, upgraded our catch with another 3 good keepers. And that made us quite happy. Okay. And I think in the end of the day, we got 10 keepers. Not a good bag by any means, but about 3.5 kgs. For Zanine Dam at the moment, average bag, not too big, not too small, but not too unhappy with what I did today. To get back to the actual rods that we're fishing with, it's very important, like I explained to you just now, that when you're fishing, have the right line, have the right equipment for what you want to do. You can get these rods, which says on the side exactly what the rod is used for: jerkbait rods, surface lure rods, spinnerbait rods, plastic worm rods, jig rods. But you don't need to have 6 or 7 rods to go out fishing. A medium heavy rod for your worms, and a soft rod for your crankbaits is all you need. Something sort of a hard rod for your jig fishing. And the difference is, this is a jerkbait rod. If you see the tip of this rod, it's got a very soft tip, but a very strong back. This allows people to catch fish on the jerkbaits. Allows people to catch fish on the jerkbaits without pulling the lure out of the fish's mouth. Very important when you're fishing. Very similar conditions with the surface rod, the pawpaw rod. Again, a softer tip even than the jerkbait rod. It allows people to Basically go in there, strike on the lure without pulling the lure out of the fish's mouth, very important. But a strong backbone in order to get the fish away from structure, etc. Your fluke rods or your rubber worm rods are a lot stiffer, much stiffer. Got much less tip at the moment, a lot more backbone. Two-thirds of the rod is strong, it doesn't move much. This means that you're catching a fish in a weeder situation. You want to get it out of the structure as quick as you can. Very important to do that. When you're fishing with your crankbait rods are slightly different again. Crankbait rods don't have a tip. They just, the whole, it moves right from the butt. It's a round rod like that. And this is allowing people, again, when you're using your specialized lines, that the lure is absorbed in the fish's mouth and is not pulled out when you strike in the fish. Because the biggest mistake people have is when they see the bass striking, or you see the fish come up and eat the lure, you tend to strike too quickly and you're pulling the lure from the fish's mouth too quickly. Get the right rod, get the right reel, get the right fishing line, and you're going to have fun. You don't need to buy expensive stuff. There's a lot of good quality stuff out there. Any shopkeeper who sells fishing tackle will be able to help you, or any friendly bass master out there will be able to help you get the right tackle to start a fishing. Get the right equipment and enjoy yourself out there.